Go ahead and begin. Thank you.
If I could just remind folks, I think you're going to do this in just a second. The board, we've had a world language Basel adoption process underway. You all have appointed people. It's been approved by the board months and months ago. So now we're sharing with you the kind of the culmination of where we are with that Basel adoption process. We're going to talk about the challenges we have with regard to textbook funding, and that will be at the end. We'll kind of give you an overview of where we are on various content areas because our textbooks are not on a regular cycle. And so we'll talk about that at the end. But really, we're bringing this forward to you because I think the committee's completed their work. They have a recommendation, and we need to explore maybe how we're able to fund this request. So, Dr. Presidio, I think you're going to set us up. Okay, Dr. Presidio.
I think you just did. The only thing that I would add, that was a great introduction, is that this is scheduled as a new business item for the board on the March 31st board meeting. So we want to make sure that we walk through some of the technical questions with everyone today. And again, this is actually a new process that we're going through in terms of our timeline and our process. And we'll talk about that a little bit more as well. But one of the largest changes is to try to work with the board up front to make sure that we've identified our funding strategy before we would ever ask the board to take any action on adopting materials. So with that, I'm going to introduce you again to Noelle Clemenko. If you don't know Noelle, she's our Director of Curriculum and Instruction, and she's been working really hard with our World Language team on the adoption process.
Good evening, everyone. It's nice to see you all. I'm going to give you, just as I've been set up here, a little bit of information about where we are in the world language process, and then end with kind of that larger look at what's looming ahead of us for the next several years. Starting with as Dr. Presidio said, that we have tried to change the process a little bit. And it's not only to inform you all, but also to really stop and think before we just start on this cycle of adopting textbooks. So if you look at the slide behind me, we started with a needs assessment. We felt it was really important to have teachers and principals weigh in about, is there a need for textbooks in the 21st century? And is there a need for textbooks in which particular grade levels or subject areas? So we did start with that process back in the, I think it might have been last spring or early fall, with the world language teachers. And what we learned is that world language is a subject in which textbooks are still used on a fairly regular basis. So that gave us sort of our charge to start this process. The next piece, which is completely new to this process, is the RFP. And in the past, the VDOE has done the work of reviewing texts and making sure that everything in the text was approved, and we could just work off their list. But VDOE has stopped with that process, starting with this world language adoption. And so we worked with procurement to do an RFP process. That, of course, added to the workload and the time of the process. And moving forward, we're assuming we're going to have to do this with all our curriculum areas. The next piece that we also moved forward in our process was community input. In the past, we had the committee do the work, and then the books that the committee recommended, we opened up for the community to view and give comment on. We moved that forward so that the comments of the community could be used by the committee as they were making their recommendations. So that process has already happened. The next part was the committee review, where the books came forward, and this committee was approved by you all and has multiple stakeholders, with teachers, with parents, with experts, that all participate in many, many hours of reviewing textbooks and kind of looking at different criteria so that they can make a recommendation for your approval. The other piece that we have done is we've talked to vendors to say, well, these are the things we like. How much will they cost? And I think this is what Dr. Garza was alluding to and Dr. Presidio, that we really want to know up front before we bring the materials to you all to approve the materials, how much do these cost? Because that is always going to factor into the decision-making process. So as you can see on the slide behind me, there's lots of check marks. We've done lots of things, but we're sort of nearing the end, but actually a very critical part, where we determine how would we fund these books, and then, of course, asking you all to approve the materials. So taking a look and just walking through just a tad bit, did we have a need for world language books? I already mentioned that world language does tend to use the books pretty heavily. But just for a little bit more information, our last textbook adoption was in 2009. Our German books are actually from 2006 copyright, so they're actually even older than 2009. We have high usage, and many of the resources really are not aligned with contemporary cultural and linguistic shifts, so we need to look at an update. The other piece is, some people may not know this, but our first online adoption was with World Languages many years ago. We got the hardback book, and we also got ebooks in a very one-to-one. Every student had an option to use both. So as we move forward, as we're nearing the end of this cycle, we are losing our availability of those online because the subscription will end. Of course, the hardback books will stay in existence in our schools, but many of our schools have come to rely on those ebooks as they've had the hardback books maybe have disappeared or worn out over the years. They sort of go to a model where students can choose which kind of book they'd like to use. So there definitely was a need, and so we moved forward with the process and had the committee. And I just want to say before I move on, we do have two teachers here with us from the committee that later during the questions, if you have some specific questions about the process they went through or the materials, they would be happy to come up and answer. But in general, as you will see when you get the report at the end of this month, the teachers are very excited about the new resources, that they really know how to leverage technology. They're much more engaging, provide more opportunities for students to practice and get feedback. Talking a little bit about the cost. Very hard to have it behind me, excuse me. As we think about the cost of these books, one thing that is important to realize is that as we're moving forward, we are looking at the hybrid sort of one-to-one, I'm using that term, but one hardback book for each student and online access for a student. So we're not looking like we have done in some of the past at doing a little bit of hardback and a little bit of online. We just feel at this point where we are, we still have students that have learning styles and preferences as well as technology access issues that we do not want to exasperate all of those things by going to some other kind of model. So all of the things we'll talk about tonight is with that intention in mind. It is important to know that typically we adopt Spanish, French, German, and Latin through this formal process. Our other lesser taught languages go through a less formal adoption process. What I share with you tonight, there will be no Latin books because none of the vendors actually met the requirements of the RFP. So we will have to pick that back up in the fall and take a look at what might be available. As you can see, in general, the cost of a Spanish book is about $100 and a French book, and German is a little bit more expensive. Typically, the less students using a book, the more expensive it gets. We also tried to look at cost savings by perhaps not buying a 7-year subscription, but looking at a 3-year. But really, if you look up on the slide, it's about a $4 difference, so it was not the cost savings that we had hoped. Another thing that is unique about World Languages is that we adopt it 1 year at a time. So you would start with a level 1, and then the next year level 2, and the next year level 3. You want students to stay in the same series so that it is articulated up through the courses they need for an advanced diploma towards graduation. We do also look at books that are beyond level 3, and you will be asked to approve books beyond level 3, but those are not typically purchased centrally. There will be, just as another piece of information, as I mentioned earlier, some of our subscriptions are ending with some of our current books. So if we are not to move forward in order to keep some of the ebooks intact and available to students, there would be costs associated with that. And the price can range. We've had prices from $11 per book to $25 per book, depending on the vendor for that. So looking specifically at dollar amounts and keeping in mind that World Language is much smaller than a core curriculum adoption, this would be the cost of implementing the three languages, French, German, and Spanish, each year for 3 years until we had fully articulated that series, and the differences for the 7-year, 3-year, and 1-year packet. even though world languages are high school courses, we do need to remember that about 50% of our middle school students do start level one courses. So when we start to think about how might we fund these, we really historically have had two methods to do that. One would be to have the books approved by you all and then ask schools to use their per pupil funds to buy the books that they need. And it's sort of an upfront cost. So for example, if you need a Spanish book, if you need Spanish books, it's $100 per book for the schools to do, to pay. And often what that does is some schools say, well, I can't really afford it to do it this year, I'll do it next year. And then all of a sudden, we do not have consistent resources across the system. The other thing that as we look at more resources that are online, it really is more difficult to support that and have centralized account management. And also, when we do our negotiations for gratis materials, it's just harder to keep track of if it's not done centrally. So starting with our social studies adoption, which was two adoptions ago, we began a different type of funding where the county upfront purchased the books needed, and then schools paid back to this pot of money each year through their per pupil. And that money was set in reserve for future adoptions. So what this allowed is it allowed schools to purchase the books, or essentially to buy the books, manage the books, make sure the materials were there, make sure we had equity and a more seamless implementation, and have the schools pay it back over time. The hard part about this this second model that I think works really well for schools is, as a system, we have to find the upfront money, and where will that money come from? So looking at the next steps for world languages. The next steps for the world language is the materials approval, as we've mentioned, that will be coming to you. And when that comes to you as a board, it does not have dollars and cents with it. That is really just the committee and community comments, as well as the books that we would recommend that you approve. That's one of the reasons we're having this conversation today, as we said, to provide that context. After the materials are approved, we will need to finalize a funding strategy, purchase, and then really look at what's the best implementation plan so that teachers are comfortable with the materials and we can have a nice, smooth rollout of these books. So those are the next steps for world languages. But before we kind of conclude, we did want to give you, thank you, we did want to give you a glimpse of what is coming our way. The first line that you see up there is the world languages that we've been talking about, but all of our textbook adoptions really fall in line as VDOE adopts new standards. So if you look at that column that says new VDOE standards adopted, you'll see that January 2016, social studies, math is coming in September, language arts the next January, and science, actually, we just learned on Friday, is going to be postponed to January 2018. So we have a little bit of a breather room there, but it is one after the other after the other. So these textbook adoptions are going to start to roll here, along with all the other work that comes along with revising curriculum and getting ready for new assessments. But it's kind of an interesting, you know, I think it's an important glimpse to sort of have this on your radar as we're moving forward over the next several years. So once we have the standards adopted, then we can start the basal adoption process. Again, starting with that needs assessment to make sure that we need to move forward. And that process does take about 18 months by the time you go through all of the steps and all of the approval. Thank you. This next slide kind of gives you a glimpse about how much, if we were to predict today, might this cost overall. Instructional Services worked with Financial Services, and we asked one of our vendors to provide us some estimated costs for math books, language arts books, social studies books, etc. And we used the same sort of strategy that we currently have. So for example, in mathematics, we adopted books K through pre-calc. So this calculation is based on if we adopted books K through pre-calc. Now we may decide based on the needs assessment or leadership guidance that we don't need to do that or we need to do more. But for now, we just wanted to base these numbers on what we currently have. So taking a look at this, you'll see the projected costs. The world languages is slightly different than the other slides because we did estimate in what Latin would cost to add that into the future. And then we have the social studies, math, language arts, and science. You'll notice that social studies and math, because we had used the second methodology where we've been pulling money back from schools through the per pupil, we do have some funds in reserve to apply to these expenses. And so then you have the total across the years. You'll notice that the amounts get higher and higher as we serve more and more students in these courses, in these core curriculum courses. So with that, I'm going to open it up for, oh, yes. Mm-hmm.
Languages?
Sure.
How much is the annual cost? Right here, if you could explain this a little bit further, please.
Sure. Because we roll out world languages one level at a time. So if in the fall, we were to buy level one books for those three languages, it would be about $1.5 million for the 7-year license. If we decided that we wanted a lesser license, not 7 years, the prices would go down. But as you can see, it's not substantially less to buy for less. It is less, but it's not a great cost savings.
So that's a one-time expenditure that keeps our license in place for 7 years or 3 years or 1 year.
Correct.
So it's still just a one-time cost.
That is right? A one-time cost. And then that would be the one-time cost. And then if we went with the second funding mechanism or strategy, the schools would pay that money back. We would have a payback. But regardless, the cost is about $1.5 million for the first year.
Okay. Thank you for explaining this. Yes, this does make this much better. When we decided to do the payback central purchase, which I think was a welcome change, I guess my question is, did that process, is it going to fully, it's basically a sinking fund for those of you, yeah, which is how the Board of Supervisors do a lot of things. We create a sinking fund, the money comes back. Will you project that will actually cover the entire cost? The cost goes up over time because so the per pupil allocation for materials, which is always in the budget each year, and it is set, part of the staffing, part, I mean, so it's all, the money is already in the budget. So I guess that's my question.
Next to the last slide.
Right. So social studies and math, we've created the funds in reserve. So the funds in the reserve will not fully cover the cost. Is it because what we purchased turned out to be more expensive, or we just couldn't get the money back? I mean, why? Because when we first rolled it out, the hope was that it would be sufficient over time.
So it's paying back the cost of the books from the last adoption, and the cost of materials are going up.
Okay, and so it is the cost of materials going up. Mm-hmm. So when we contract with a publisher, when we first contract, isn't that a fixed rate contract?
This is assuming a completely new adoption.
Oh, yes.
Okay, so this, all right. At some point, we'll have to go through another adoption process. And so we're assuming when we do that, based on what we know about today's cost for materials, it will be greater than the monies that have been set aside.
Okay.
For those two areas, social studies and math.
But is the intent to, if we get the mathematics correct, is what we put in the budget and assume a textbook cost per student per core subject, will that really be enough then over time for the schools to pay back what we've had to pay up front? In other words, is the sinking fund sufficient to cover the cost? Because that was the discussion where we had hoped that it would be some years ago when we went to that.
So no, I don't believe the sinking fund is going to fully cover the cost. So when we started down this process, we were assuming that our cost for textbooks would only be going up marginally. But when you look at the cost for the new textbooks as compared to the per pupil that we were taking from schools, the cost of textbooks is increasing faster than the inflation rate we included in our original assumption.
Sounds like prescription medication and more students. But each year we set a certain textural amount per student as part of our budget. So I guess that's my question. Are we not budgeting enough up front? Should we be increasing that amount per student? I mean, how do we create a sinking fund that actually matches?
Yes. So in hindsight, right, when we factored in the inflation growth cost for textbooks, we should have used a much higher rate. So one of the things that I would say is textbook companies are for-profit companies that have done well in terms of making sure the cost of their product has continued to increase. So in order to make these sinking funds a better solution, what we need to do is factor in a higher replacement cost. So as we're reducing the per pupil allocations to schools, we're taking a higher amount per student, so we're ready to pay the higher cost 7 years from now.
So we need to budget a higher cost in order for it to be. And is would we budget a higher cost that escalates each year? Because it has a has an impact on the central budget for this. So in other words, going forward for the FY 2017 budget, do we have already enough money to begin the sinking fund so that 7 years down the road there will be enough for these for the world language books?
So
we're going to have to pay an upfront cost, but that's what I'm saying is that will we get that cost back?
So when we started our sinking fund concept, what we did was we used one-time funding from year end to pay for the full cost of the textbook implementation. Then our intention was to reduce the allocations that were given out to schools over the seven-year period by enough funding so we had the same amount of funding available to buy, to do that initial investment when we purchased them again, right? In hindsight, we really just did not project that the cost of textbooks would increase by this percentage. So likely what we'll need to do when we renew these adoptions is add additional one-time funding and then reset the per pupil amount that we are taking from schools to a higher level so we're well funded for the next adoption.
So for the initial upfront cost for the world languages, is this already been figured into the 2017 budget? So
no,
is the
no.
proposal to do this again as a one-time cost at year end and then create the sinking fund that will replenish this because it is a one-time cost?
Ideally, that would be the same methodology and would allow schools to pay for that cost over time because purchasing them all up front for schools to pay that amount is a very large
right.
amount
I know
for
they
schools.
Can't. Centrally, we can.
And because their budgets have not gone up at the campus level, even though they've gotten, you know, they're – they will tell you this is a strain on them to pay back this money on an annual basis. So you'll hear it from principals. But if you'll go back to slide the one with the just the cost of materials for just world languages, this one. So the decision we have before you as a board is how would you all what approach would you all want us to take? We could do the bring forward at a one-time money, the 1.588, the seven-year package. That one-time money would cover a seven-year package for year one, but keep in mind that very next year we would have to pay $972,000 for year two, and then the next year $785,000 for the year three, and then we'd be done until –
well, it would start overlapping though with socials, you know, with other.
I'm talking about for this one though.
Right.
I'm just focused on the world language right now, but that's what I was talking about. Just to pay for this, this is what the cost would be.
Okay, I've got Karen, then Il Young, Tom, and Megan.
I should have also finished. Then the board could decide whether or not you want to charge back, just like we did for social studies and math some time ago. You could all decide we want to charge back the schools the cost, just like you did with social studies and math. So that decision is also an important part of the conversation.
Thank you, Dr. Garza. Your last comment is exactly why I think we have to look at this a little more holistically than just the world languages, because this year it's relatively easy because we're only dealing with one textbook. But next year you're talking about year two of world languages at the same time as having to deal with the social studies. And it doesn't sound like when we put together our 2017 budget that we've actually included monies for this. And so my question is there something we can do? We've got end of year monies that we expect of about $8 million, am I correct? Or, no, I forget. What was the... Okay, so if we can...
You did approve at third quarter a set aside of about a little over $5 million, right, not to be expended yet, just to determine what we would have. Remember that? And then there will be, you know, we always guess about 34, 30. I don't know. I don't know how much we'll have a year in. We have a beginning balance to concern ourselves with.
We have a beginning balance requirement. I wouldn't want to, at this point, estimate how we're going to end the fiscal year with, because right, we haven't done that yet.
So, but we know we have a little bit that we'll have at the same time as we have expenditures that we haven't budgeted. So one of the questions I have as a board would be, are we better off front-loading the projected world languages costs for the 3 years and using that money, those monies, to then start asking each of the individual schools to start paying us back and creating a sinking fund that is not fixed on just one individual line of course, but rather as a sinking fund for textbook adoption. That gives us more flexibility. And if we pay the 3 years up front for the world languages, will they be willing to negotiate a lower rate?
I think with negotiations, we can pose anything we want. I don't know.
That's correct. You know, when we originally created the sinking funds, we did it when we adopted social studies and when we adopted mathematics. So as you could see from the chart, we've separated those reserve amounts. But I don't think there's anything that says the board can decide there should just be one textbook reserve sinking fund. And as the requirements come up, that we would go ahead and use the sinking fund to replace those subjects that are need to be replaced as it comes up.
I think the one thing we would just want to make sure that we did is, as we're using the sinking fund, we need to make sure that we're in a position where we're able to fund the upcoming replacements. Because if the online materials are no longer available, and we use, say now, we go ahead and use some of the math funding to help us do the social studies books, right? We want to make sure that we are thinking long-term as we're allocating the funding out across the different books.
That's exactly what I'm driving at, is that if we actually front load, and then it's almost like lending ourselves, giving ourselves a line of credit longer term, and that line of credit then gets replenished by all of the different areas.
And we have to keep in mind that as we've been pulling per pupil allocations from our schools, we haven't increased their textbook accounts. So as we continue to pull per pupil allocations from the schools, that's going to limit the school's flexibility on how they use that funding. We have to keep that in mind, because prior to the recession, each time that we did have textbook adoption, we had new money going into textbook adoption. But since the recession, that's one of the things that we cut, and then we are trying to fund it through the sinking fund process.
Neil Young?
Okay. 7 years versus 3 years. When you say subscription, is that mostly online support with a subscription, or...?
So it is a hardback book, and then the 7 years of the online resources. So it's not just the book, but other resources, you know, videos, okay, and teacher materials.
And textbook allocation to each school, is that based upon purely a number of students, or is that based, so what the courses students take do not make any difference? You know, for example, some textbooks cost more than others.
Correct. So our current per pupil allocation is only adjusted based on level. So elementary gets the smallest amount, then middle, then high school, and Thomas Jefferson does get a higher allocation. But you're correct. There's no adjustment based on how many students are taking what courses,
okay,
or what those textbooks cost.
And on world languages, you said that there was a French, German, and Spanish, and Latin. Latin. So all the languages not included because there aren't enough students needing textbooks. With the Chinese becoming more and more popular, still not part of this?
So I did look that up just recently, and we have about 6 schools, I believe, offering Chinese, and the others are at 18 and above. So we're still not quite there, but I think we're moving in that direction.
Okay. Going back to textbook data allocation, we are still giving on an annual basis. That's in our budget, correct? At least giving the, each school the textbook allocation. And that has not been enough to actually for schools to purchase.
Not for complete adoption. That's
not for
correct.
The complete adoption, because I was trying to go back to earlier comment you made that schools may say that we do not have enough funding, enough money to purchase. Do you think why, if you have not given schools enough allocation, how could any school be able to say that we have enough money to purchase?
Right.
Is that because they are using some other funds to supplement the needs, or?
I think it's also likely that the school may not purchase it. So if they know that they need to purchase them and they don't have enough funding, they may decide, I'm going to try to save funding over a number of years till I have enough money to make that outright purchase, right? They know that when they start this process with level one, they have to move through the other levels. So my guess is schools would be fairly conservative in making sure that they had that money up front. So like Noelle said, I think it's likely that not all schools would start that purchase process because they wouldn't have the funding available.
Are the schools allowed to spend textbook allocation for something else other than purchasing textbooks?
We allocate funding for textbooks and instructional supplies, so that's correct. They could use it if they were buying workbooks to supplement the regular textbook or other instructional supplies.
Now my question is this. Because schools do not have enough funding to purchase textbooks with their own money, and if the schools, for their own needs, used part of the funding or all of the funding for something else, and if the school system decides to pay for the textbooks, how do we hold the schools accountable for the prior allocations we have given?
So the way we do it now is when we funded up front, for example, the math textbooks, and we paid the initial purchase price on a central level. When we allocate out the per pupil funding to schools, we make that reduction prior to us allocating out the funding. So they get the textbook allocation less the funding that they're paying us back to refill the sinking fund for both math and social studies.
Okay, thank you.
Under those two content areas, it's not voluntary. We force the decision. Mm-hmm.
Tom, followed by Megan and Elizabeth.
Yeah, thank you again. So if I understand correctly, right now, the world languages is still in a voluntary basis that each school makes that decision, or is that not accurate?
So for the past adoption, which was many years ago, that was how it was done. We have not made the decision how these world languages will be purchased yet.
So with the past adoption, how much uniformity was there across the school system? What actually happened then if each school had discretion?
So the data that I have is looking at when subscriptions end, and they're ending at all different times. So schools purchased over a span of time. I don't have the exact number of years, but you will find that sometimes schools will continue to use the books that they have for as long as they possibly can until that they can find the money.
I also think it's probably important to note, we actually reduced funding for textbooks and instructional supplies as one of our budget cuts. So schools actually now have less funding, 15% less funding than prior to us going to this online purchase methodology.
I would also point out that schools are oftentimes right now having to make decisions around AP, science, text.
Absolutely.
You know, so, I mean, we're only talking about division-wide decisions. You ask a principal, they're spending a lot of money on textbooks every year out of their supply money, particularly in these areas where we haven't adopted a long time and they're having to pay for AP. I hear it more in the area of AP probably than anything else.
So with that information, then, if we were to make a countywide decision on world languages to fund, say, the seven-year plan, how much overlap do we have with existing subscriptions that schools have funded?
So I don't have the exact amount, but we could find that out for you. What I will say is that we typically, schools purchase it in the rolling sort of way, where they bought level one, then level two, and level three, and we would follow that. So I don't have that exact information. We've been trying to work with the vendor, because when those purchases happen, we didn't do it centrally. Each school had their own little contract with the vendors. So it's a little bit harder for us to get a handle on where everybody is. But we've been trying to do that as we've been looking at the possibility of having to extend licenses.
And so the license cost data that you have in here, is that presuming that you're doing it countywide? Or does that take into account that some schools still have, you know,
Because we would be moving to a new series, we kind of are hitting the reset, getting everybody on the same schedule with the same textbooks, moving through the three-year cycle.
Could it be less is what I guess my question is?
No, it couldn't be less, because we wouldn't hold some schools to continue with their license in the older text. At this point, I think it's, as I said, I think we want to hit the reset and have everybody moving forward with the new text at the same time, so that 6 or 7 years from now, we're all ready to move together.
And have you done any analysis for those schools that have, you know, years left on their program that they've purchased? Is there a loss that we would basically incur by doing this now? Is there a savings if we wait until everybody's expired? I'm just trying to understand.
So. We can try and dig a little bit deeper, but by waiting until everybody's expired, we would have to incur costs for the people who have expired to keep them current, right? So important question is, I don't believe it's years that people are still active, but we can certainly try and get to the bottom of that.
We could find out which schools still have subscriptions remaining. Maybe they do know back there. Somebody's raising their hand.
I'm Gregory Jones, World Languages Coordinator. All subscriptions will end in this year, 2016. So we're all moving toward that end, and actually we've actually been in consultation with some of the vendors to actually extend contracts for the existing resources so that students will still have access to those resources. But this year, all those resources, they'll come to an end.
Okay.
With regard to subscription.
Yeah, I think that's very helpful. So the figures that we have here, who was the vendor that provided the estimates? And do you think that there might be a second or third vendor that could provide another number that we can evaluate?
So for the world languages, those are the numbers for the books that we are proposing to you all to approve. So those numbers are not really estimates. Those are the numbers based on our enrollment and the negotiated contract prices.
With what company, though, I guess is my
question. The companies that we're looking at are Pearson and
Houghton Mifflin.
And Houghton Mifflin. Thank you.
Vista, Houghton Mifflin. Okay. Those are the two.
Okay. And when you went through the process of getting those proposals, do you do a... You do an RFP, and
yes.
They have to come forward,
yes.
And they're the least cost to that met all the requirements.
So each textbook company, we go through the process first, looking at the curriculum, and then we determine which ones we would recommend to the board, and then we negotiate with those vendors. And Tina Smith from procurement is here because she does that actual negotiation, so she may want to add something.
Hi. Yeah, I'm a contract administrator in procurement services upstairs. In the RFP process, it wasn't necessarily the lowest cost, because it's an RFP, we take into account best value. So we made sure that they met the curriculum requirements, and the school board, the textbook committee helped out with that. And then also the IT requirements. We had IT involved from the beginning to make sure that the online portion would be supported. And then once the recommendations from the school board textbook committee came out, then we went forward to the negotiations for those publishers whose titles were recommended. And in terms of price, I know price was brought up a little bit earlier. They are required to give us the lowest national price. Now, when we ask for a bundle with free things and gratis teacher ancillary resources, that'll increase the price because, of course, for them to be able to give us all the free stuff, they have to put the cost in somewhere. But overall, they should give us the lowest national price.
Thank you. And I guess lastly, is there an option to sort of a do nothing option where we can get through the next school year by, you know, some other means and potentially find a spot in the budget where we can save some money?
There's always a do nothing option. Obviously, teaching and learning will continue to happen, and we'll use the hardback books that we have. Maybe we could have one of the teachers come up and speak to the impact of that.
Oh, thank you. And I'm at Robinson Secondary, so I'm kind of on both ends of it. So I actually brought along, when we mentioned that everyone adopted the textbook on different lengths, not everyone actually adopted the German textbook because there were promises made when it was adopted that we would get a new video. It never happened. So a lot of schools chose not to adopt it. I was looking for some data and I never quite could get the numbers down, but every German teacher I've spoken with, a handful have adopted the new textbook. The old textbook still has the D-mark in it. It was published in 1999. The pictures come from the 80s, maybe. And just looking at the globally minded citizens we're trying to create, we're really looking at, you know, some fashion that might actually come back into style at some point, because it always does come back. But it really, I don't know if you can see from that, it's not so great. And our students are really, and they have been for many years, but they comment on it. And trying to explain to them why their homework is in D-marks, or, you know, as I do, I convert it myself and I type it up. We have no online resources. We haven't had workbooks in German for years and years and years, the Deutschmark. It's okay. We've had the euro for a long time now. This book actually makes mention of the euro, that it's coming. It's very exciting. East and West is, you know, well, it's still talked about. It's not quite separated anymore, but it's still talked about as if it might have been very recently. And so I think when we're talking about, you know, we're really trying to get these kids to understand the world at a much larger scale than just Fairfax County. And the books are not really helping us do that. And a book is just a resource. The teachers do the teaching. However, I will say that without the resource, teaching gets a lot harder. I can still teach. I've been doing it for a while with this. But it would be really helpful to have those online components. And especially if we're looking at getting the one-on-one students with computers, I don't have any technology to share with them with this textbook.
So it doesn't, I mean, I guess the nutshell is that there's really not a sort of do nothing option that is makes sense in our system. So is there, give me the reasons why I would preference the 1 year package, because it looks from a cost standpoint like there's not a whole lot of savings.
We're recommending a one time of the 7 year package.
Okay, so there really isn't any benefits like flexibility or something, nothing. Okay. Okay, thank you.
Okay, Megan.
So for our new colleagues on the board, I want to share with you some history since I'm a history major by training. Our math adoption that we did when we first joined the board, the veterans outside of Janie and Neil Young who served before us, it was a nightmare when we pulled back the curtain and understood what happened. And this it precedes Dr. Garza's arrival, and it actually precedes Dr. Presidio's arrival, and basically just about everybody up there almost. But here's the problem in a nutshell. My former colleague Patty Reed and I spent an extraordinary amount of time on the math textbook adoption debacle, and are grateful to Dr. Presidio, who was amazing, trying to step in as new to the position and clean up the issue. But here's where it is in a nutshell that my line of questioning is coming down. What I learned from that math textbook adoption is the school board voted, yes, of course, we need new textbooks. That was it. then staff went and said, oh, you know, the cost to do hard copy plus online subscription, which we had done with World Languages and everybody loved because you get both, you're only getting online. Well, guess what, folks? Online for math, as we came to know, was a nightmare. The platforms were a mess depending on who the provider was. And thank goodness for Dr. Presidio's legal background so he could even, you know, use those skills. But what it meant is we had families who were going out and spending hundreds of dollars to individually purchase the textbook. We had high schools that were blowing their entire year-long copying budget because the teachers felt so badly for the students. So I hope you all don't mind. It's either here at the work session or it's at the board table when we go to vote. But I really want to vet this thing as a board member so I don't get burned on a decision I make. Are we looking at a hard copy textbook for every student with the online subscription accompaniment? Okay, good. That's what I wanted to hear. Well,
you know, we're an organization that learns from our mistakes. That's why we're having this presentation. This presentation tonight. We didn't want to surprise anyone, and we need to have the broader discussion about how we're going to fund these going forward, yep, because this is a major issue.
So, you know, I know we were short on time, but I think it was important for the four new board members and to remind my existing, you know, or my veteran colleagues who maybe didn't spend the amount of time I did on it, but it was a huge, huge time suck. And it's still, I will tell you, a problem as of last year, my own son sitting at a table without a textbook for math, even though his mother fought for every kid to get a textbook who needed one. But his teacher still didn't know that she could say, you know what, you need a textbook, I can get you one. So thankfully, we won't do that with World Languages. Second thing, Dr. Garz, is I might differ from a lot of my colleagues on this one, but I'm just not really a big fan of having all this funding down at the school level. If we believe as a school division that this is the textbook, this is what we need, and we're going to have equity and access to all of our schools, then it's a countywide purchase, and here you go. And this whole saying to the schools, you know, okay, now you need to pay us back. We're your parents. We're providing you the resources you need at the school level. So I don't like this whole paying back thing. If it's something we need to do as a division, we do it. We provide it. It's
pointed out our schools don't have that kind of resource. I mean, they've been maybe they used to not. So I get your point.
I'm so, you know, and the other thing is that in terms of looking at what the funding on this, I think this makes perfect sense when we have that one-time funding and we say, well, what can we do with it? And all of us are so eager to increase a teacher here or there. It's like, no, that's recurring funds. I mean, this is what this is meant for. So, you know, I think it if we have that, then I'd like to reduce the work time on staff, wringing their hands on how are we paying for this thing, and just say, okay, as long as our CFO or our chief operating officer say, you know, this is how you can get it done, and let's just get it done and move on to bigger and more challenging things. And to our amazing teachers who make do with books that almost date back to the birth of my children. Thank you for the ones who are both in college now. Thank you for, you know, your passion that you bring to the classroom. And please know that in the end, what we're saying all up here is how can we make the teaching experience you give to our students the most dynamic and exciting and a quality education that Fairfax County residents expect for our kids.
Okay, so in our I had the advantage of the meeting manager discussion. What was the impetus of the state to push down purchasing of textbooks onto the individual school divisions? And again, on our focus on legislative stuff or work with the state policy, because there is a purchasing power that could be obtained if there was a statewide purchasing vehicle, and we would there'd be some return on investment at the state level in us saving money, correct?
So my understanding is that when books are adopted at the state level, that's what we have used to choose from. But the cost that we pay for a textbook is the same as the cost that Prince William pays regardless of the state approval process. We all pay the same amount for the textbook. Where the differential comes is from the gratis materials. We get more free things, perhaps.
Mm-hmm. I do think the shift with regard to the RFP process, it's really become, I think it is, it's shifted that burden to the local school systems and has added, I think, a lot to the workload. So I think there's definitely costs associated with that shifting of the RFP process. Would you all agree about that?
I would agree with that 100%. I mean, we've got a highly skilled technical procurement office. You think about small school systems that don't even have that. I mean, I think it's really a shame that that this has been allowed to happen. I mean, we can do the work here. It's a lot of extra work that we shouldn't have to do. But there are other systems that really can't do this technically.
Okay, I should know this figure off the top of my head, but I don't. How many K through 12 students are there in Virginia? A million? Okay, over a million, because that's got to be right. Okay, so if there were a central purchasing vehicle created by the state based on requirements established by the individual school districts and said, hey, listen, we'd like you to create a purchasing vehicle for this, and instead of needing 10,000 of them, the state buys, you know, 52,000 or 152,000, there has got to be a savings. So once again, I'm back to policy at the state level on, you know, effectively looking at ways to put a thumb to the jugular of either the State Board of Education or the Secretary of Education and say, listen, you are costing us, and oh, by the way, every other school division across the state, the Commonwealth, more money by not creating something as simple as a common purchasing vehicle. You're making everybody go through the process. And even if you could, you know, get some of this gratis stuff off the top, but the cost of us going through that process, it's a wash. It's what I'd rather, like, you know, let a small contract here for any additional services we need and then just be able to tack on to. I mean, this is just like federal purchasing. And so I don't understand why we're not pushing the Secretary of Education, the Department of Education, and our state legislators to create these purchasing vehicles to save us money. So that's number one. Two, the cost of the schools having to pay us back, I'm 1,000,000% in the same boat as Ms. McLaughlin. There's got to be a cost associated with appropriating monies to the school level and them paying us back, tracking it back.
We actually don't allocate it out to them. We deduct it prior to processing the allocation, so it doesn't go out and come back.
Okay. So, because I will tell you on the ground, and I'm not identifying anything new. Dr. Presidio and I have had this conversation, as well as many others. The notion that every kid who wants a textbook can get one, it's the tin can game. We say it into the tin can, and somewhere down the string, it turns into you may absolutely not have a textbook. So whatever we can do in the policy formation or in the regulations to say we're allocating this money, we're keeping it, and we're going to give you your allowance. And your allowance is here, and oh, by the way, if a kid wants a book, they're going to get a book. That has got to be, and I will say, doing the student town halls, over and over again, the kids say that the need to be in front of technology all the time and the online textbooks get a major from the students. They need that book. The parents need the book to help them. So whether it's elementary, middle, or high school, that's key. And there was something else, but I don't remember, so I won't say anything else to save us time.
Okay, I have Pat and then Sandy and then Karen.
Okay, just briefly, I do agree. I think we should go for the 7-year license, right? That seems to make the most sense. And I agree generally with the idea that we ought to be paying for this rather than the schools. I don't know if we can do that now. That's more of a future conversation. I just had one question for the teachers, I guess. Tom Wilson, you asked, you know, is there sort of a do-nothing option? I think a do-nothing option actually is also costly. And I wonder if the teachers could speak to this, because when you say, I can teach with this very old textbook that has no online resources, I think what you're saying is actually you're going to spend a lot of time and money on copies and, you know, being online and looking up your own stuff.
Hi, my name is Michelle Fahorley. I teach at Longfellow Middle School and then previously at Langley High School. And so, as Gregory pointed out, the subscription is ending this year for everybody. So Langley actually didn't start with the new textbook that was adopted in 2008 until a year later, but their subscription is ending this year as well. And so with the materials come consumable workbooks. Well, if you say do nothing, then all those schools have to purchase workbooks next year because they're not getting any from our current contract. In addition, because the current textbooks we use, while they have an online component, it's not very good, meaning I can tell my kids to go to the site and do activities, but they're not getting the immediate feedback and I'm not seeing their results, whereas the new company or the new textbook, at least for Spanish and French, they have that immediate feedback and teachers can see exactly what their students did. They can see what areas they struggled in and they can use that data to plan for their teaching. And so schools now, to supplement what our current online textbook doesn't have, are purchasing additional site licenses for outside companies and vendors that do that, whereas the new will already provide it. So there will be sale costs for sure.
Thank you, Pat. Sandy?
Yes, thank you. And thank you for bringing your show and tell. That's very helpful. I think I have all those clothes in my closet, by the way. Yeah, so on the 7-year package, which, I mean, clearly that's a much better deal, I'd like to understand what's in the package, though. What grade levels are we talking about here? It's not grade level?
So it's level one. It's Spanish, level one German, and level one French.
So it
could be in eighth grade, it could be ninth grade, it could be 10th grade. Students access this at different points.
So not at elementary school?
Correct.
Okay, so just secondary school?
Correct.
So we're talking only secondary school. And we're talking only French, German, and Spanish?
Correct.
So what about the other languages?
So, as I said, Latin is usually part of this package, but we had some difficulty with them complying with the RFP. So we did not have a sufficient number of Latin books to actually look at. Mm-hmm. So that one is on hold, and we'll have to do that one at a later time. We did also look at beyond level 3 to level 4 and AP and IB in these three languages. And those are going to also be in front of you to approve. But historically, anything beyond level 3 and outside of those four languages have been done through less formal processes and purchased at the school level with school funds.
So we don't typically have a textbook for Arabic, Chinese, Korean.
You all don't typically do an approval process because it's such a small number. We do a more informal approval process, including the teachers and of those languages. And then once those are done as more program materials, not basal materials, okay. And then schools would have the option of paying for those and purchasing those.
And those are done, and the payment is from the schools as
Correct.
Opposed to central.
Correct.
So if we were going to pay for this at the central level, we would be paying for French, Spanish, and German at the central level, but still expecting the schools to pick up materials at the school level. Is that correct?
The materials for other languages and levels beyond level 3.
And okay, and for anything at the elementary level.
And with elementary, we do not use a textbook.
So okay, so that's just. But that does that also come? Do any materials at the elementary level come out of the budget of the schools, or is that's a school issue?
That's more of a school issue. We provide curriculum and resources to them, but not basal resources that go through this formal approval process.
Okay. And then my last question is just if it could be broken down by language, or is the package the package, or can it be broken down French, German, and Spanish?
I have more specific numbers.
Okay.
Just for interest, we have about, for level one, we have about 3,600 students in level one, and then level two, it drops down to about 2,000, and then level three, it drops down to about 1,600. So that's why the numbers are reducing. The price of the book doesn't change.
I see.
Okay. But it's the number of students enrolled is why we have the differential there. But I can certainly provide the more detailed breakdown of costs.
Right, for the different languages. Mm-hmm. That'd be great. Thank you so much.
By language, by level. Mm-hmm.
Just a quick go back. I wanted to bring it back, maybe take it up a level to the VDOE standards adoption schedule. How much time do we have? What's the lag between when the VDOE adopts a new standard and when we actually have to have it incorporated into our curriculum? Because it seems like we may not have a lot of flexibility in choosing a do-nothing option if it's being driven by the state pushing out new standards.
So I think that becomes more evident in courses where we have SOL testing. Than world languages. World languages does have standards, but it's not quite the same. So, for example, with social studies, we are going to be implementing next year sort of what we call a crosswalk year. So we have the new standards and the old standards, and we're sort of in that crosswalk where we're doing a little bit of both. When they get to the end of the year on their social studies test, there will be field test items for those new SOLs, those new standards, and then in 17-18 will be the actual SOL test that changes. So the state gives us a little bit of time to kind of get used to it before the accountability piece is put in place. So it's typically 1 year of a crosswalk year, and then the next year is the assessment. I think with language arts, the tentative schedule is 2 years of a crosswalk year, but that could change as well. And the process really takes us about 18 months, especially now with the RFP process involved. That adds a whole nother layer. And then just getting the teachers and the committees together and moving in the contracts. I mean, there's a lot of steps to textbook adoption that creates workload for many people in the division.
Thank you. Just a couple questions myself. Back when the state level was doing the textbook adoption, would that have included the smaller attendance languages? So would that have gone into the Chinese, Arabic?
I do not think so. Those are not commonly taught across our state, probably most commonly taught here.
Okay, wonderful. And as a teacher who did have to purchase a lot of online materials, because that's where you get a lot of the communication that we really need, I really appreciate if we can have materials that come with that. And on a lighter note, what will happen to all of our books if we adopt new ones or current books?
Typically, when we have textbooks, we box them off. We send them to the warehouse. Different things can happen. They can be donated to other countries or other states or other schools. They can be sold. It just depends probably on how old they are and how much in demand they are and what condition they're in.
So if they can be sold for some kind of profit, we do look into doing that.
Okay. We've given them to other countries, too, the older, outdated.
Thank you.
Might I just make one last comment? I really appreciate this conversation. Our textbook decisions are really important decisions because it's that one resource where we know every student. When we purchase it ourselves, and I'm glad that you all were talking about that, and we say this is our standard, then it doesn't matter whether one school has a lot of resource and they've purchased a lot of the materials or another school that may have limited extra funds where the students don't get it. So I appreciate the conversation around, if we're really serious about equity, these are the kinds of conversations we would be having about how we handle decisions around textbook adoption. So I really appreciate, I think, the conversation. And then one final thing, I think we could go back, Kristen and Susan, and do some modeling around, certainly we're going to have to move forward with some of this, I think, but we could look at what would the model look like if that became a textbook fund and not a fund just for social studies and mathematics, but really became a textbook fund? I think we could start to do some modeling around that, couldn't we?
Sure. And I think Chris and I were talking when we're sidebarring over there. I do think we need to have escalation increases. That's, I think, the problem we're running into with social studies and math books, because it was a flat set aside for 6-7 years. And if we really want central office to be picking up all the textbook replacement, and I think we could also have a policy at the end of the year with one-time funding to put additional funding into the textbook sinking fund so that we have sufficient funding when those replacements come up.
Janie, and then we'll do next steps.
Okay, I just wanted to say for all of you who have been on the board only in times of declining revenue, we didn't used to have this difficulty. Years ago, when there really were, when funds were available, we adopted cycles on whatever was required, and we simply bought them, and we bought enough, and we didn't have an issue of equity or schools not having enough money or children not having access. This is an interesting, this is what happens when you continually just don't have enough money. So this is a new problem, or I should say it has been a growing problem. 10 years ago, this didn't happen.
Do we have, okay, we're going to just wait for next steps.
Okay, then what we'll do is you all have to approve the textbooks anyway. That requires your approval. Anytime we go through an adoption process and we say this is the committee, they vetted all of this, RFP, you have to approve them. And then I'm assuming you all are comfortable with us considering the actual funding of them at year end when we get to that place, or in the coming months with the $5 million that has been set aside. We'll Is that correct? That's what I've heard, I think, from all of you. Okay. It would still require your approval. I'm just saying, getting some direction from you. Mr. Wilson's looking at me in a funny way.
I'm just not sure I understand what you're saying.
I think what I was trying to say is we needed, to some extent, some direction from the board about moving forward with the adoption. All you're doing in March is approving the particular text that the committee is recommending. And then at some point in the coming months, we'll determine how we actually fund that, whether that be through the set aside of the money from third quarter or monies out of year end. Is that correct, Susan? Did I state that correctly? Or Kristen?
That's correct. We're just going to need another board action if we go ahead and spend the $5 million set aside down the road.
This new business on approval of the materials, yes. Not the funding.
Right. You just have to approve the titles right now, and then at some point we'll have to figure out how we, in the coming months, we'll bring back a different action item to you all for the actual funding mechanism.
So, Mr. Wilson, if I may, at that point, the board has an option not to fund.
Could I?
Which means you're not purchasing it.
And I'm sorry, for those board members who have never approved a textbook before, I mean, if I looked at a German textbook, I probably would not know whether this is a good one or not, right? So we're going on the advice and recommendation of our Basel,
the committee.
Yeah, there will be a written report that includes the findings of the committee as well as all of the community comments.
I think we're having technical difficulty, so we'll send out the next steps and let us know if there's anything that's missing from that. So we'll take a couple minutes. Thank you all for being here and getting us through the process, and we will finish up with governance.
Thank you all, too. Okay. Appreciate your work.
That's good.
Board.